Pero is snoring.
is
Sorry,
it?
my dog's snoring in the background.
Ah. Welcome, everybody. Hi. Lovely Saturday afternoon out there. Thanks for coming. Yeah. All good your end, Vanessa?
Say again.
All good your end?
Yep, we're good.
Yeah. Natalia, we still got people coming in. Hi, everyone.
Expert animal. Let me not encroach on your
animals. That's they're going to do what they're going to do.
You know what I mean? Yes. Try to get their face.
Wait just a couple more minutes. Oh, no, not just a couple more minutes, maybe just a little, one more minute. So we've had quite a lot of people interested in today's show, so we might just wait a couple of minutes just to get everybody on board. They're still coming in. Have you all had a chance to go? I asked them, Vanessa, if they could go out and have a look in their own backyards to see if they could see, observe what's out in their own yards or out in the open spaces. Yeah.
Yep. I've been out in the garden and I'm telling you, there's so much out there. So
these are my favorite animals on my lawn.
Who's that?
Bees.
Oh, bees. Sean, Ranger Sean is allergic to bees.
Ah.
But I want to get more. I want to get beehives. And he said he's going to quit his job if I get beehives.
Well, it's a, you know, life or death situation.
Oh, look, I said he can stay at the shed and the beehives will be up here at the house. Dilly said no.
I saw the bee show. Oh, we talked about the Honeyland film, and the Sydney Bee Club was there, and there was the conversation was around bees are like pets, having pets, like you really need to look after them and be able to water them and feed them.
Not feed them, but yeah, stick the box out there. And
that's right, and off you go.
Yeah, that's right. That's like all animals. You got to do a little bit of work to look after them.
Yeah. All right, well, should we get started?
Yeah, everyone in?
I think a lot of people can't. I think people are, oh, hi, Charlie and Tara. A lot of people have, well, there's people come in, but I think it's 3 minutes past two now, so let's get the show on the road.
Yeah.
Okay, so hello, everyone, and a very warm welcome to week two of Ramwick City Council's Eco Living Festival. My name's Helen. And this week's all about bees, bugs, and biodiversity. And today's event is all about bugs, which is very exciting. Firstly, I would like to acknowledge the Bidjigal and Gadigal people who occupied the Sydney coast, being the traditional owners. On behalf of Ramwick City Council, I acknowledge and pay my respects to the elders, both past and present, and to the Aboriginal people in attendance today. So today's session is live streamed. If you would like to ask a question, please put this in the Q&A function, which you'll find at the bottom of your screen. And Vanessa and Sean will ask the question, answer the questions at the end of the show today. And we'll try to answer as many as we can. So also after today, after the session, we hope you'll be feeling really inspired to take further steps in appreciating our bugs, nature and biodiversity by getting involved in some of Randwick Council's current environment programs. So look out for those at the end of the show today. We'll also be sharing a QR code that links to our survey, and we'd really appreciate your feedback. And also a backup email will also be sent directly after the session if you miss this link, because we're really keen to get feedback on what we're doing here and how our programs are going and how that we can improve. Okay, so now it's over to the stars of our show. Please be introduced to Rangers Vanessa and Sean to reveal the secret lives of our backyard bugs. Over to you, Rangers.
All right, excellent. Let me get Sean to start this thing. Excellent. No, can we go back to the very beginning? Let me just get rid of that for a sec. Oh, look, Ranger Vanessa's not very good at technology. That's why Ranger Sean is right beside me. All right, beautiful. Okay, so you should be able to see Ranger Sean now. And Ranger Sean is going to hold the animals. Oh, did we do split screen? Everyone knows about that?
Oh.
Does everyone know split screen? So that we've got the photo, what was this called?
The presentation.
Presentation on one side and then Sean on the other.
Yes, so if people can look at their screen and you can go into view, we've got side-by-side speaker. I can do side-by-side speaker. Okay.
Oh, Abby's up and running. All right.
And if people can see the screen, if there's the presentation on one side and Vanessa and Sean on the other, there's a tiny little on two little strips that you can use your cursor and make the presentation bigger or smaller. But I'm sure that you're all pretty savvy with that. Okay, thank you.
Excellent. All right, let's get started. So obviously there's lots and lots of different types of bugs out there, and we will talk about just three groups of bugs. We're going to start with the bugs that have lots and lots of legs, the myriapods. Then we'll move on to insects with their six legs, and we'll finish the show with arachnids, who have obviously eight legs, our spiders, scorpions and so forth. Why isn't that going? Oh, here we go. All right, so starting with, I might just get rid of that. Starting with millipedes. So Sean's holding red-legged millipede. This one's from Queensland. So it's one of our giant millipedes. Millipedes are really important for the environment. Where are we going again? Oh, there we go. They break down leaf litter. They're really, really friendly. So leaf litter is just all the leaves, the sticks and so forth that fall off the trees. They break it down into smaller pieces, and then all the soil microbes, even the worms can bring it down so the plants can use those nutrients again. So they're part of the recyclers. If you scare a millipede, he'll usually just curl up in a circle. They don't bite. But they can release a really smelly liquid. If this gets on you, it's called millipede burn, but it's not really a burn. It's really just staining, and it looks a bit gross, but it just stains your skin. So just be aware, they don't like pats in the wild. Animals don't usually go up to another animal to pat them. They go up there to eat them, so they freak out straight away. First thing, as I said, turn into a little circle there. And the second thing, if you keep touching them, they will release that stinky liquid. So just remember, if you get it on you, go wash your hands straight away. If you don't, that's what it's going to look like. It just looks a bit gross for a few days. But they've got lots and lots of legs. And as they grow longer, they just keep growing more legs. They're a really interesting little bug. Millipedes. If you see one in your garden, be nice to them. They keep our gardens healthy. Now, the next ones with lots of legs are centipedes. And there's a big difference between millipedes and centipedes because centipedes are the ones with the fangs. So you'll see this black bit at the end. So that's the fang. It's actually legs that have been changed into fangs. And they release venom. And right in the middle, that's actually his little mouth. So he holds an animal and then chews away at it. Yep. So this one's a giant centipede. This one, oh, you won't believe me, but I found it at Epping, which was actually in Sydney, right next to a soccer game. So kids were there playing soccer and I decided just to kick over a few logs and I found it. And it was only a baby at the time. So we've had her for a little while. So they live for about 5 years, but they can get bigger than this. So, yeah, we've had a few in the past and they've gotten much bigger than this. And when they do get large, they act a little bit like a snake. They can rear up and they can bite that way. They also, as I said, live under the leaf litter, the logs, the rocks. They want to be in cool places. They can also dig down into the dirt. So all my fellow gardeners, just be a little bit careful in the garden. Just make sure you've got gloves on or you're using your spade, your tools to dig in the dirt. So just be a little bit careful because if you get bitten by a centipede, a bit blurry when it's so close to the camera. Oh, we're okay at the moment. Okay. So just watch out because they can get below that soil surface. Now I'm going to show you a man who actually got bitten by a giant centipede. And this will make sure you use your gloves and tools in the garden. It's really a painful, painful bite. All right, so his name is Coyote Peterson, and he let a giant centipede bite him. Here we go.
I'm Coyote Peterson, and I'm about to be bitten by the giant desert centipede. Here we go. One. Two. Right there's the fangs. When you see those puncture marks?
Oh, yeah. Grab the fangs.
Immediately searing.
All right, that means
hot. Oh, my gosh, so much worse than a bullet ant sting.
I think I'm going to vomit.
Okay. Oh, my gosh. This is really bad. Now, we have never used the venom extractor before in an episode, guys, and it is so painful right now, given the isolation of where I was bitten. When I was bitten by Gimellaro on my thumb, we couldn't use venom extractor. I'm going to try and see if we can't suck some of that venom out of my forearm. The pain is so bad, I actually was almost in tears. This absolutely eclipses any insect sting I have ever taken. It makes the bullet ant feel like a bee sting. It makes 30 bee stings to the face feel like putting on facial moisturizer. This is the most intense pain I've been in since the Gila monster. And in this moment, I am regretting being bitten by the giant desert centipede, guys.
Now, centipedes, because they've got the poison, they can actually kill animals bigger than them. This one's only killing a really small snake, but they've had giant centipedes. They've filmed them and taken photos of them killing like up to 1 meter snakes. So they really can hit above their weight. They're an amazing predator. And they're needed in the garden. Without them in the garden, they're going around killing things like baby beetles that are eating the roots of plants and snails and caterpillars, all sorts of things. So they really keep bug numbers down. But just be aware, because they've got the venom, and the venom is seriously painful. So really hot, and the pain lasts for a long time. If you get bitten by these big ones, you're in pain for hours. And I was watching the Kings of Pain just the other night on TV. They did the giant centipede, got bitten by that, and they were in pain for 12 hours. Half a day of pain, forget it. So just use your tools in the garden and put on your gloves so you don't get bitten by these centipedes. But if you see one, don't be mean to it. Just maybe get it on your shovel and flick it out of your way further down the garden somewhere where you're not going to be digging, because they're really important in the environment still. All right, that was myriapods.
Bugs with lots and lots of legs.
So millipedes are your friendly little ones. Remember, they're scared. They'll roll up in a circle. Worst they can do is stain your fingers. And the centipedes, they're the ones with the venom. But now we'll move on to insects. And we're going to start with phasmids. These are your stick in your leaf insects. We'll start with stick insects. So this one, oh, she's only a baby, can you believe? She's a baby or juvenile, we say, Goliath stick insect. She hasn't even got wings yet. So when she grows up, she will grow her wings. But check this out. I'll come in next to Ranger Sean. That is how big she was. Do you want to bring her back for a sec? So this is her old exoskeleton. So bugs have their skeleton on the outside of their body. So she was that size and now she's this size. So they grow a lot all at once, whereas you guys probably didn't even notice that you grew last night, because we grow just a tiny little bit. Well, kids do. I've stopped growing. But kids do. Kids grow a little bit every day. Bugs, because they don't grow every day, it's when they molt, when the exoskeleton comes off, it's soft underneath, the new one, and so they just squeeze and stretch their body, make themselves bigger. And Sean is holding a boy at the moment. He's turned into an adult. Oh, hang on, he's gone onto my fingers. And so as an adult, do you want to show them the wings? He's grown his wings. You might need to hold him from that end.
The boys don't like their wings being touched.
Which side are we going?
All right.
Oh, gosh. Just.
Tiny.
There we go. No.
Down.
Oh, geez, I'm not the hand model. Sean's the hand model.
There we go.
So he's grown his wings. And now if he loses a leg or a bit of wing, he actually won't be able to grow it back. But as a juvenile, if they lose a leg, so as a child stick insect, if they lose a leg, next time they grow bigger, they can just squeeze out a whole new leg. So, yeah, bugs can grow back their body parts, but not when they turn into an adult. Once they're an adult, that's it. Whatever happens, they've got to live the rest of their life without a leg or an antennae. All right. So stick insects, really cool. You can have those as pets. And most of them eat gum leaves here in Australia. So you go out and you just get fresh leaves and get a spray bottle to spray the leaves with water each day. Very easy bug to look after. Now, the other phasmid that we have here are the spiny leaf insects. Here's a leaf insect on your picture here. This is more a tropical one. But we've got the spiny leaf insects here. girls are big, boys are skinny. It's a horrible, horrible thing with bugs. Girl bugs just have to be big and fat so they can have lots and lots of babies. And the boys, the lucky ducks, get to be super skinny and fly around everywhere. But the girls do last longer. So the girls, well, for these guys, the boys are really lucky to live to 1 year. And the girl, oh, she'll get almost to 2 years, not quite. For the stick insects, the girl will get to 2 years if all goes well. But lots of things like to eat stick and leaf insects in the garden. So they try and stay as still as possible during the day and do most of their moving about after the birds have gone to bed. That's their major predator, the birds. Phasmids. They lay eggs that look like little plant seeds. Sorry, I spat on Sean's computer. And they have a little bit of ant food on the end of the eggs, and a lot of them get brought down into ant nests, and they're kept really nice and safe. Nothing's going to go in there into an ant nest. So when the little babies, particularly with these spiny leaf insects, when they come out, they actually really do look like an ant. And they've got the ant smell, which is really interesting. So I'm sure most of you have harassed an ant and got that horrible ant smell. Well, that's what these guys smell like. So spiny leaf insects look like an ant when they're born, and that gives them enough time to kind of get out of that ant nest, and they'll just go straight up the nearest tree they can find and start living their life up in the trees. Look at this cute little face. So sticky insects have really cute little face. They've always got the compound eyes. And we'll talk about simple eyes a little later, but all insects will have two or three simple eyes as well. And they're just little eyes between the big compound eyes that can just see like light and dark. They don't really see properly, but they've got super cute faces. And again, awesome pets, very easy to keep. So if you're looking for a pet, not a cat or a dog, then definitely look for a stick or a leaf insect. Can a centipede kill a human? Not in Australia, but overseas they can. And, well, I would suggest you don't bring home a centipede. Leave them in the garden. But people do have centipedes as pets. Yep. The biggest millipede is the giant millipede from Queensland. So that gets probably, 20 centimetres? And biggest centipede, it's actually the same genus, isn't it? Or species? Scolopendra?
Same genus.
Yeah, so what we showed you, so that's Scolopendra. So all Scolopendra centipedes. Oh, we lost a bug. Flew off. No worries. Get it later. But, yeah, so they are the biggest in Australia as well. All right. Back to this. Oh, my God. Oh, this is my favourite. Okay, when stick insects get a little bit scared, they do this funny dance. And someone's put a bit of music to this, and this is my favourite thing ever. If I repeat it too many times, I do apologise, but it's one of my favourite things. Watch this stick insect dancing. Oh.
Oh. What to do?
I don't know. Oh, what's happened?
It stopped, so press play and play again.
Wouldn't want a stick insect. Very, very funny little animals. They don't bite. Now, there's an animal that does look like a stick insect. but it's got stronger front legs, and it's the praying mantis. Now, these guys are just starting to get to their adult stage. So we've got big babies at the moment. They actually come out of an ootheca, it's called. So this is the egg sac of a praying mantis. The female, she actually makes it. So it looks like shaving foam coming out near her bottom, and she makes the egg out of that and then lays her eggs in it. And then when it dries, it looks exactly like that. And she just walks away. She actually doesn't look after her babies. But the babies, when they finally hatch, and they hatched at the end of winter, early spring, and they just go off and they start their life. They can look after themselves. Now, you'll notice that they've got really big eyes. Praying mantises, their eyes take up almost all of their face. They're really big, and they can actually see behind them and in front of them at the same time. The front legs are really strong, and they've actually got little spines on them. So when they grab a bug, those spines help them hold onto it, and then they just start eating it alive. It's a bit horrible, really, watching them eat. But there's two different coloured ones up here. The one in the middle, perfect camouflage, and they do. They're so good at camouflage. They can stay still for hours. You won't even see them, but there's some really, really pretty ones that live in flowers, and they'll be the exact same colour as the flower, even almost the exact same shape. And poor old bee comes in to pollinate the flower and gets caught and eaten by a praying mantis. Here's their eyes. So they've got enormous eyes. But what I want you to do is look right in the middle. There's those simple eyes. So again, they're just picking up light and dark and movement. It's the big compound eyes that can really see everything. Just the little simple eyes alerting them, I guess, to movement. And of course their antennae can sniff things out, sniff food out. Not much gets past a praying mantis, truly. They're such a great predator in the garden. So remember, predator kills animals to eat them. You cannot feed dead animals to a praying mantis. They will not eat it. They must catch the food themselves. So just be a little bit careful if you're going to, can praying mantises kill you? No, no, they can't.
If you're a fly.
Yeah, if you're a fly or a grasshopper. They like crickets too. But yeah, so just if you're going to catch one, yeah, have a look at him for a couple of hours, but put him back out in the garden. And those ootheca's, they will be, the egg sacs, they will be, yes, on your fence or on a plant in the garden. So as soon as you've seen one of those in your garden, you know you've got praying mantises. So keep an eye out for them. As I said, most of them are just going to be babies at this time of year, but they grow fast. And within probably about another 3 weeks, there's at least going to be a few adults in the garden too.
Then some of them can fly after that.
Mm. All right. Particularly the boys fly. The girls get a bit too fat to fly. Oh, here we go. Talking of flying. Caterpillars. One of my favorite bugs. Not particularly in the veggie garden, but I do love caterpillars. And they're really interesting because caterpillars must be the yummiest things in the garden. So they have to protect themselves. So some of them have these eye spots, and it makes them look like bigger animals. So this one here is trying to look like a lizard, a frog. So they look like bigger animals. So if a small bird comes in, goes, oh, hang on, that's a lizard. I'll go have a look for something else to eat. And the little caterpillar gets to live another day. Some, they just have really, really bright colours because this is a poisonous caterpillar. And so it's got the spines, of course, but those bright, bright colors just straight away are warning other animals, don't eat me, I am poisonous. Well, I think we picked one of these up, didn't it? This one's a eucalyptus cup moth, isn't it? I don't think we picked this one up down in my paddock. So, but keep an eye out for these. So if it's got really bright colors, it's just trying to warn predators that it is poisonous. Now, Sean's holding a silkworm. So some of you guys might have silkworms. And these are caterpillars that have been in captivity, so been raised by humans for thousands of years. And in fact, they can't survive in the wild anymore. And they make silk, say silk pajamas and sheets for the bed. So silk, their silk is made into material. And caterpillars turn into butterflies and moths. And often the really hairy ones will turn into a moth. A lot of our moths are kind of like a browny grey colour, very, very good at camouflaging. They'll just stay really still on a tree and you just won't be able to see them. Now, Sean's got a case moth. These are the ones that put sticks on their cocoons and they'll go around the garden, and as they get bigger, they make their cocoon bigger and put some more sticks on, and you can actually see where the moth came out. So they chew a little hole in the end and out they come. So I just picked that off the wall yesterday, that one. So there'll be a case moth flying around somewhere here. Some of our moths use, and even butterflies, use eye spots as well. This is the, so this is the owl-faced moth. Looks like an owl face. It's just, cool. Very, very cool. But check out this butterfly, a glass wing. So as long as it stays still, it totally looks invisible. And yeah. You can see right through it, just wonderful looking butterflies. So praying mantises, they only live for a year. In fact, some, particularly the boys, live for less than a year because sometimes the girls eat the boys. Sometimes the girls just chop the boy's head off. So caterpillars brightly coloured, but are some caterpillars brightly coloured but not poisonous? Well, it tends to be a thing poisonous animals do.
Yeah, the generally ones that do that just live on plants that are brightly coloured. So they're brightly coloured themselves to camouflage in, but usually in the animal world, bright colours mean don't attack me.
Mm. Do you know, even those leaf insects, some people feed them roses, rose petals, and when they're young, they can turn pink and colours of the roses. So, and I saw a cricket once that was on living on a rose bush, and it was bright pink as well, just like the roses. So, yeah, sometimes it really is what they eat. How do you tell the difference between a moth and a butterfly?
Do you know the difference?
Antennae?
Yes.
Yeah.
So the old rule of thumb that I learned by at uni is you've got to get the antenna, which the long thing is coming out of the head, look that under a microscope. And if it's just a long sort of string, we call that a butterfly. But if it sort of has fur or fuzz right at the tip of it, that's when we generally classify them as a moth.
Yeah, so usually...
they're essentially the same animal, but their antennae are just slightly different.
Mm. Yeah, and they often have, the butterflies often have a little club at the end, don't they? Yeah. Like a little circle at the end.
But it's not fuzzy or anything, there's no hairs coming out of it.
Yeah.
The moths are hairy.
And it's interesting because I once saw a big poster of all the moths and all the butterflies in Australia. And there was only a few butterflies. Almost all of them were moths. So, no, it's incredible how many moths are out there. That was a good question. All right, we'll go back here. Oh, here.
That's our butterfly.
These are the butterflies we breed, the monarchs, or in Australia, we actually call them the wanderers. And because the caterpillar feeds on a plant called milkweed, which is poisonous, then they can carry that poison into the adult stage. So they use bright colours again to warn predators. They are poisonous. Do not eat them. Beautiful butterfly though. So you'll see these around Sydney. Oh, there used to be so many more, but we just keep, you know, crashing down habitats to put houses on. So we've just got to remember animals need homes too. And these guys like to live on farmland. So their plant grows as a bit of a weed along creek lines and on farmland. But they kind of introduced themselves, didn't they? The plant, the milkweed, and the butterfly kind of introduced itself. So they look after each other. And we love we love monarchs. So we wouldn't want them to go anywhere. Oh, cockroaches. Most people's worst fear. But can I just say, cockroaches are just really, really important. Just like the millipede, these guys are recyclers. You're showing them her bum. Oh, dear, oh dear. Poor darling. This is a giant burrowing cockroach that Sean's holding. And this one lives at the top of New South Wales and at the bottom of Queensland. So it's got quite a big area that it lives in. It's inland though. And she eats the eucalyptus leaves, bark, wood, and she'll bring them down into her burrow. She's a bit different to the other cockroaches. She has live babies, whereas most of the other cockroaches lay eggs, and they lay hundreds of eggs, some of them. But she'll only have, oh, maybe 10 to 15 babies. The cockroaches who lay eggs, hardly any of their babies will survive. Most of them will die. But because she looks after her babies, almost all of her babies will survive. So they've all got a hard exoskeleton. No, she doesn't like it. So hard exoskeleton. A lot of our cockroaches do have wings, not our giant burrowing cockroach though. So most of them can actually fly, and they'll hide under things. So they'll be living in rotting logs or under the logs, under the leaf litter. And of course it's their food as well. So if you're looking for the native cockroaches, you have to go out to the bush. If you've got cockroaches in your house, well, they're actually not from Australia. So all of the native Aussie cockroaches are out in the bush. Some of them are actually up in the trees as well. And they'll even be feeding on the flowers or flowering trees, feeding on the leaves. But most of them do tend to be on the ground. Oh, and this is interesting. Cockroaches have developed a defense against wasps. So wasps do like to
come in. A biologist at Vanderbilt University investigated the initial wasp-roach confrontation. He set up a series of high-speed cameras and then put the two insects together. Here's what happened. There's a flurry of action as they wrestle for control. Suddenly, the cockroach unleashes a kind of karate kick straight at the wasp's head. Let's watch it again. The cockroach turns away from the wasp, raises its body, and strikes. Those spikes on its leg, they're like barbed wire on a bat. Sometimes the roach just shakes off the wasp without a kick. That's what it's trying to do here. When the roaches fought back, about 2/3 of them escaped. Roaches that didn't defend themselves, they got stung almost every time. If you're a cockroach, clearly you've got to go for the kick. Just don't miss.
So cockroaches, they can fight back depending on how big the predator is that is trying to attack them. But most of them just try and hide. that is their main defense, is to hide and to maybe come out at nighttime when most of the predators have gone to bed. But remember, in your house, they are not Aussie cockroaches, okay? But don't try and spray around the outside of your house, because you'll be killing the really good bugs as well. But inside, fair enough. It's your domain. Fair enough, you might want to use poison, but just outside, remember, poison kills everything, even the good bugs. Beetles. All right. Beetles are really interesting. Do you know, a lot of them are not quite adults at this stage. So most of them are larvae, and that's what Sean is holding. This one's going to turn into a fiddler beetle later on. Google fiddler beetle. They're an awesome native beetle. And what they do is they eat the roots of plants. So next time you change a plant over out into a new pot, you might notice that there's these grubs, and they are baby beetles. Now, beetles, we've got the rhinoceros beetles in your other picture, and they have horns, and the boys will fight for the girls. And these beetles that fight with each other, it's quite interesting because for most bugs, the girls are the big ones, the boys are the little ones, but not for beetles that fight. The boys can be much, much bigger than the girls. And of course, have those big horns on them. Rhinoceros beetles are one of the beetles you can keep as a pet as too. So if you want to keep one as a pet, look up the internet. There's a few sites that sell those. But you can just go out to your garden and find beautiful beetles. The one that we're going to show you,
if she'll stop moving,
is the seven-spotted beetle. She's a eucalyptus beetle. She lives in everyone's garden on the east coast of Australia. And just as easy as those stick insects, you just have to get some new leaves for it every week. And again, doesn't bite. It's a really, really cool little beetle. But this one is the bombardier beetle. So this one's really interesting because it's got two chemicals in its body. And if something comes to attack it, it releases those two chemicals together. And when they come together, they form an acid, and an acid burns. So you can imagine if an animal's come in to try and get him and he sprayed this in their face, they really would not think twice. So they'd be running off in utter pain, I would say. So bombardier beetle, that one. So most beetles, there's a lot of beetles living in rotting logs, under logs as well. There's basically a beetle that lives everywhere. They live in every habitat. They eat just about everything, don't they? I mean, even when the cow does a poo in the paddock, off along comes the old dung beetle. Yeah, goes, oh yeah, this is good, this is tasty, and rolls the poo up into balls. Puts an egg in there, and then poor old baby dung beetle eats the poo-poo and then comes on out. Oh, even dead animal bodies. So animal dies in the bush. Beetles like the carrion beetle, the devil coach beetle, then they will come along and they'll eat the flesh. They'll lay their eggs in there as well. So just like flies, beetles are decomposers. Oh, we're up to spiders. Oh, now, a lot of people are terrified of spiders, but can I just say, spiders, almost all of the spiders in Australia are either harmless or mildly venomous. And mildly venomous means it might hurt, or for a few, it might get to a stage where you might feel like you're going to vomit. But that is the worst that most spiders can do. A lot of those spiders are absolutely harmless to humans because, I mean, look at us. We're giants, okay? Those poor little spiders, they only have enough poison to kill things like flies and mosquitoes and little bugs. This one here is the St. Andrew's cross. She makes the white cross in the middle, and her favourite food is flies. So she just sits there all day waiting for a little fly to fly into that web, and then she wraps it up quickly. Up the top are these funny sacs called egg sacs. There you go. So in each of those egg sacs, there could be 50, 60 eggs. So they really can have a lot of babies, but most of our spiders don't look after their babies. So just be aware, most of the baby spiders, even if you see 100 come out, a lot of them are not going to survive. And in fact, half of them are going to get eaten by their sisters and brothers, to be honest. It's a rough start to life. But really pretty. St. Andrew's cross, keep an eye out for them. And if you see them, definitely don't hurt them. They're wonderful, wonderful spiders in your garden. And they just look so pretty. They're yellow, black, red and white. Jumping spiders. I love jumping spiders too. They're pretty cool. They've got giant eyes at the front. Which is the most dangerous spider in Australia? It's that Sydney funnel web spider. We'll get to him a bit later. Oh, there you go, funnel web spider, speak of the devil. So, all spiders have venom. It's just how they kill their food. So, some have only enough venom to kill little things like flies. Others, like the funnel web spider, can kill big animals. And it's interesting because your cat won't die, but we will. It's just a quirk of nature that their venom can kill humans. It's not like we were a major, you know, predator of them.
Well, it's because just, they can kill small mammals.
Yeah,
it comes to work with us.
Yeah. Oh. Well, you might see Sean's holding up a spider, and this one's called a wolf spider. Thank you, Sean. And if you have holes in your lawn, perfect circle holes, it's a good chance it's actually a wolf spider. These guys come out at nighttime, so you won't usually see them during the day. And they do, they basically run after bugs and just jump on them and bite them.
Get my partner.
Yeah, they do. They just run incredibly fast. So they do scare people. And
they're like a sort of stands up with their legs up high.
Yeah, well. They're a beautiful spider. Just be aware, they are one of the spiders that if they bite you, they can make you feel like you're about to vomit. So he's a mildly venomous one, that one. But you might find one with a door on it. It might be a trapdoor spider. Some trapdoor spiders don't even put a door on their, burrow. So a hole in the ground might be a spider, but often those spiders come out at night time. Some of our spiders use camouflage. This little one in the picture is a wraparound spider, really little one. The one that Sean's holding on the wood with the web around it, that is mother huntsman spider. On her eggs, and you know what? Actually, those eggs, they've got to be well into 2 weeks now. So she's probably got one more week of guarding them. And then her little babies will start to hatch. And she truly can have like close to 100 in there. And they all come out and they live with mum for first few weeks. And the strong ones, they will eat their brothers and sisters. But that's how they just make sure the strongest babies get out there. And she's such a wonderful mother. She really won't leave those eggs. She'll protect them the entire 3 weeks. She won't feed, so that's why she's got that web on the outside, just to keep her safe. She knows she's not going to be able to fight anything off. She's going to be really, really weak at the end of 3 weeks without feeding. But a wonderful mother. Very fast runners. Like when you do try and catch them in the house, they can be a little bit scary. Do be aware
They won't be on the ground. If they're on the ground, they're probably dead. They're a tree spider. So they tend to be up on your walls or on your ceiling. They can actually walk straight across the ceiling without falling off if you don't scare them. But, yeah, try and get a big container over the top of them and get them back outside because they're a wonderful spider. Favourite food is cockroaches. So if they keep coming inside, it might mean you have a cockroach problem. Oh, we'll come to peacock spiders in a moment. Okay. I love insect hotels. Can I just say I built an insect hotel in my garden during COVID, and I love insect hotels. So if you guys, and there's no exact design. You can be as artistic as you like. So that's a good little, well, it's not quite a holiday, is it, at the moment? But, you know, it's a good little weekend project because it only took me a weekend to make mine. And you can just use whatever stuff is around the garden, just different sticks. You can drill holes in wood and in bricks. I've got bricks in mine. So bug hotel, I say, should be one in every garden. So do try and make a bug hotel. Oh, okay, redback spider. Now, Sean's got our redback. She's got her eggs. So often they'll make a really messy spider web and then they'll have these circle egg sacs. And inside, oh, gosh, she can have up to 200 babies in each of those. That's why it's terribly difficult to get rid of redback spiders. They like to live under things. So if you've got outdoor furniture, holes in bricks, even, you know, around your fences, they like to hide in areas like that. So just be a little bit careful when you are outside. And if you do see a messy spider web, then just either don't go near it, or if you do need to get rid of her, I mean, it's fair enough. Some parents will have to get rid of the redbacks in their garden. It's just too dangerous. Redbacks can, in fact, kill children. So can't kill an adult, but it can kill children. So not that it does anymore. We've got anti-venom. That's the special medicine. You just go off to hospital and get your anti-venom. But it's a very, very hot bite. And you'll know if you've been bitten, and so will the kid. The kid will be screaming. So just, yeah, if you do, so often they'll only leave one fang mark. Sometimes they're ambos when they turn up. If they just see one, they'll put an ice pack on it first. And if that doesn't, because ice pack is what your first aid is for a redback spider, and the pain stops straight away. So if the pain doesn't stop, then they'll quickly move to the bandage for a child. But if you know what has bitten the child and it's a redback, just, you don't even have to rush. You don't have to rush, you're just off to hospital. But get that cold pack on because it stops hurting straight away. And for adults, don't even bother turning up unless you have a compromised immune system. Or maybe you're really, really, I met a lady who was really, really small framed and really skinny, and she did have to get anti-venom. So, but very rarely do adults ever need anti-venom. Oh, here. Now, this is the peacock spider. They are just the best little spiders and so pretty and the best dancers.
You will find many ways to have a good time. It's fun.
Now, if he dances good enough, he gets the girlfriend. If he doesn't, sadly, he gets eaten. Oh, but spiders, they're so important for our environment. And for the most part, they're only eating bugs. So they're kind of really good in the garden. Well, they are good in the garden. So do be nice to them. As I said, if they're in your house and they're creeping you out, okay. But out in the garden, try not to use too many poisons, because truly you will kill everything, including the bees, the butterflies, the things we really want out there. So please, yeah, don't use too much poison outside. Well, let's go to some. Are spiders nocturnal? All right. Now, some spiders are nocturnal and some are out during the day. So it just depends on what spiders, which spider you were talking about. But there are ones that come out during the day and there are ones that are nocturnal coming out at nighttime. What am I going to do when the baby huntsman spiders hatch? Well, we actually just let them go. So
we'll put mum in a new container, put the old one outside, let the babies sort of crawl out.
Yeah.
Put somewhere nice and safe.
Mm. Bugs are said to be a good source of protein. Do you think? Oh, yep. People will be eating more bugs in the future to replace. Yeah. Oh, I hate to say it. Yeah, they will be. And you know what? It's going to be made into flour, which is like really ground up very, very small. And you won't even know it. And,
I reckon they will just mix in with normal flour.
Oh, yeah. Eggs. Yeah. They're going to hide it. They're going to hide it in our food. We're not even going to know. But apparently, someone was eating a grasshopper the other day and said it tasted like popcorn.
It's a lot of street markets in Asia and the Middle East, they will sell insects on sticks.
I am not eating tarantula on a stick, okay? Forget it. Or a cockroach. No, I might eat a cricket or a grasshopper, but that's as far as I'm going. Okay. Are there spiders that properly raise their young? Okay. No.
I can't
think of any spiders. Pretty much. Oh, yeah, no, look.
They might stay close to a parent spider, yeah. Just for a molt or two, till they get that little bit bigger, but generally they look after themselves.
Yeah, spiders, especially when they're really, really young, I guess it's just the way that nature has made it, that the biggest, the strongest eat the smaller ones, and then it's only the biggest ones going out into the environment, and then half of them die too, the poor things. But and the mothers, I guess you got to think that if they have 50 kids living in their area, they're all competing for the same food, there just won't be enough food. So the babies have to get out further and have to find their own place to live.
Yeah, different tree, which then can be looked after.
Well, here's a good question. Redbacks, do males and females both have red backs? Only the girls. So only the girls have the red back. In fact, the boys are so tiny. They're the same kind of shape, but they're just all black.
But not all red backs are red, though, as well.
Oh, I know. They can kind of look orange off.
That's in a yellowy one.
Yeah, exactly. I've heard that. I've never seen the yellow ones, but
I've rarely seen them. Mm. I've seen them around Mount Druid.
Yeah, okay. Crickets and mealworms are already out there. Yes, that's right. Yes. So they're made into flour, pasta, and chips. Yeah, I'd go a mealworm. I'd eat a mealworm. Ranger Sean. Ranger Sean. Ranger Sean doesn't want to eat bugs. But I reckon. No way. Jill Dyson, I have a packet of sour cream and onion dried crickets here, but I can't bring myself to eat them. eat. Come
maybe
on.
Maybe just get a normal sweet and sour chips.
No, no.
Or whatever it is, just mix it.
No, let's make her eat it and tell us. Jill, eat it and tell everyone what they taste like. Probably just
Sour cream. Oh, what predator likes citrus bugs? Oh, I hate to tell you, nothing. Oh, yeah. I must admit my dad's lemon tree has the bronze orange stink bugs on them at the moment. And they start life orange, but then as an adult, they look that bronzy brown color. And they squirt out an acid. And that's why not many animals want to eat them. In fact, I can't even think of a single one that really particularly wants to take them on. Gonna have to do the old pincheroo.
Or just get a chemical on them.
No, excuse me. We're trying not to say chemicals. No, just before, like, you've got to do this early. So if you've got heaps of them already on the tree, forget it. You will have to use a chemical. But if you can get in early while they're really small, just pinch, pinch. Okay. Yeah. That's how I do it out at Dad's. And then he pretty much gets through the season without any more. Oh, here we go. Jill's eating it. Crispy. Oh, there you go. So Danielle has tried crickets. Nice nutty flavour. Oh, there's a shopping good that sells them. Here's Jill. Doesn't taste like anything, only crunchy. Oh, even the flavouring didn't help. What's the difference between a stink bug? Oh, there's a big difference. So a stink bug and a bombardier beetle. Now, a stink bug is a true bug. It's got a needle-type mouthpiece, and it drinks the sap of your citrus tree. A bombardier beetle, it's a beetle, okay? So they're different bugs. How common are white-tailed spiders, and are they dangerous? White-tails are really... Hang on, I've got a bug flying around my head right now.
They're fairly common.
They are. They're more common than you'd want to know. But their favourite food is black house spiders. Grab that black house spider. And black house spiders are the little black spider that lives around your windows.
I used to keep them at my
own around house. Your fences. Can we turn this one on again? Oh, yeah. There it is. So black house spider. Now, if you've got really, really young kids, so... I'd say 3 and under, this one, if it bites them, it makes their temperature rise. So I know that my friend had to take her child to hospital for that one.
Yeah.
But anyone above 3 is just a bit of a painful bite.
Remember, not all white tips are dangerous.
Well, it's not so much the spider that's dangerous anyway.
It's the bacteria.
Yeah, it seems to be if it picks up a bacteria in your garden and gets it on the
fangs. I do believe it's called necrotized fasciitis. I'm not 100% correct, but I think that is the one.
I'm not a doctor.
It's naturally occurring.
I'm not a doctor. The Ranger Sean.
But all right. Eats at your skin.
Yes.
So if the venom's not dangerous, like you get a little bit of reaction to it, but the bacteria will eat at your skin, killing it. And if you do get that, usually you have to go to a surgeon and they have to cut away a bit of your skin and wash it out.
Well,
give you really strong antibiotics to help cure the bacteria.
Oh, I was going to say, before it gets to the stage where you have to amputate stuff.
Well, if you want please
go to a doctor and get antibiotics.
Cleaning it will get rid of it. But if you left it maybe a day because the child hasn't noticed, then maybe they'll cut a little, not much, but a little bit of the skin away just because it's the quickest and easiest way.
Look, if you have something that's big and red and doesn't seem to be getting better.
Yeah, well, sometimes kids don't tell their
parents. Oh, gosh. truly. People have had to have parts of their body amputated, and that means chopped off kids. So if you get bitten by something and it looks really gnarly and yucky, then... please go to a doctor. Oh, someone's tried bogong moths. Ellen, bogong moths on toast. Moths are a bit furry.
And they always got like that powder to it.
Oh, I know. I don't think I'd be into moths either.
Oh, Vanessa.
Sorry. What was that?
Just checking the time. It's 3:03.
Yeah.
Should we, would I do a little wrap up and then if people want to stay on after to...
No worries. Deb Watson, just with the citrus bugs. Yeah, get your gloves on. Get your gloves on.
How do we do that?
All right, shall we do? Okay.
Or yours.
No worries. Okay. Sorry to cut you off so short. There's so many questions and what a fantastic show. If people do want to stay on after and hear, get their questions answered and hear a bit more from Vanessa and Sean, they're willing to stay on for a little bit longer, which would be great. But I just wanted to say thank you for attending today and hope that you've got some insights into, I mean, what amazing things are happening in our backyard, so busy, especially around this time of year. And if you were feeling inspired about caring for our environment and protecting these small bugs in our, that are secretly working away on our behalf, then we have some programs like the Permabees and Bush Care that you can join and get involved with, and also another program that is will be opening up soon called Plant With Us. If you want to look at other programs that Ramic Council is running at the moment, then please look at our website, get involved. And also, as I said before, let's have a look at the link. If you'd like to give us some feedback, we'd really appreciate that. And also to let you know that the recording of the session will be available on Ramic Council's YouTube channel. And I think Natalia's going to put that link in the chat for you. And to let you know that we've got lots of things going on for our environmental festival, Eco Festival. It's on for another couple of more weeks. Tomorrow we've got the Joy of Birds in Your Garden at 10 a.m. and also what's happening in the inside the beehive at 2 p.m. All right, well, thanks everybody for joining us. If you want to stay on and hear some more questions, we're happy to do that. Okay, over to you, Vanessa.
Oh, okay. All right.
So... Oh, I went too far. Hang on. Let me go back. Where were we up to?
I'll just start anywhere then.
Oh, here we go. David's come up with a solution for the stink bugs, the citrus bugs, no chemicals. Put them in a jar of... Oh, God, that sounds horrible. David! Their own, they'll gas themselves. Okay. Oh, goodness. Are children still on this channel? Oh. How do the females eat the boys with the peacock spiders? Oh, gosh. Well, they bite them and put venom into them and then just suck their insides out.
They just treat them like normal prey after they've done what they need to do. Just bind, maybe rub them up a bit so they don't lose
and
them.
They tried so hard. They danced away and she just didn't like their dance. Just terrible. All right. Okay, so Jill. Oh, why does it go so far?
There's a recipe for damper and bitter moth there.
Yeah, how do we go up just that tiny bit? See, I'm trying to get Jules. Oh, here we go. Okay. My experience of a redback spider bite, quite different from what you described. Okay. So was his.
Well, I haven't been bitten. I've heard stories about people. Everyone's sort of different when it comes to just spider bites. Like people with bees, I know people have been stung by bees, had no reaction. Me, I'm limping around if I get stung by the forks and having to go to the hospital. And same thing with spider bites. Some people have no reaction. Like huntsmen's are a really good one. People also have bad reactions to huntsmen bites. Other people, I got in trouble at a daycare once for saying that most people have no reaction because the lady had a severe reaction.
It's still going to hurt. If you get bitten by a huntsman spider,
pain.
Yeah, right. Even if it's just a common, say, one of the harmless, like our one called a common huntsman, just the fangs, the size of the fangs going in, it's going to hurt.
It just varies.
Yeah. But 2 weeks of pain, wow, from your redback spider bite.
There must be a lot of venom.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, that's a really extreme.
Maybe a big one.
Yeah. Well, big that's, bad. Yeah. Well, I've never heard anyone be in pain for that long. Went to hospital, they didn't know what it was. Oh, okay. Yeah, all right.
Your pet mice. I think mice like eating anything, don't they? My pet mice loved eating bogon moths. Yeah, look. Oh my gosh. Okay, if you want a recipe for bogon moth damper, it's there in the Q&A.
No, thank you.
No. Are hornets a species of wasp? Yeah. Aren't hornets wasps? Well, at least they're in the same family.
They're same family, but it's like saying rats and mice. Very similar, same family, but okay. Two different species of animals.
I don't know much.
Hornets are generally larger and much more aggressive than wasps.
Yeah, yep.
Yeah.
Sean, we can't see your head, Sean.
I'm good.
No. Can we get your hairy mop head in here?
A wasp and a bee does me enough.
Oh, yeah. No. They all hurt. You don't want to get bitten by any of those. Okay.
Thanks for too much curiosity for, yes. I'm more of a personally bugs alone, don't you?
Yeah, me too. Don't try and feed them.
I'm much more catch a spider, put it out in the park when my partner is very much scream, jump on the couch and panic.
Yeah. Do you have a favourite insect? I'd say praying mantises. Oh. They're pretty cool.
I do like beetles.
Yeah.
Beetles and butterflies I like.
Yeah.
But mainly because we've got all the different colours and shapes, designs.
Yeah, true. Beetles. Beautiful. There are some stunning beetles out there. Yeah. No, I reckon praying mantis would be my favourite. I've never seen a peacock spider. Where do they live? They live out here, don't they? So that filming was in southwest Sydney.
Yes.
Yeah.
But they're quite small spiders, so you won't really see them unless you're looking for them.
Oh, they're tiny.
And their tail.
Just like the rest of your jumping spiders are tiny.
They keep their tail abdomen flat when they're not
dancing.
Mm. So they'll just look like a little tiny spider up in the trees. You won't really see
them. Oh, yeah. No. But I mean, a lot of bugs are really small. Sometimes it's good to get out the old magnifying lens. Be a bit careful which way the sun's going. You don't want to go burning them. All right. What makes crater-like holes in the ground? Crater-like holes.
If you're talking about indents in the ground, some snakes do that as they curl up. You'll see like a little.
Are these little ones? Mm. Oh, no, it doesn't say little craters.
No, it says craters. Yeah, so it could be just any type of bug really clearing a little space to sleep in.
Yeah, can't particularly. Some people use vacuum cleaner to suck the stink bugs off. Actually, that would probably work.
People put it to your head, then going. Being shoved through a vacuum cleaner.
I don't think they particularly do want them to survive. Otherwise, you can't just let them go somewhere and then they'll just come back to the tree. Oh, here we go. Danielle had a severe reaction to wasps. Is there a natural way to keep them and not close to, okay, keep them in your garden and not close to the house? Well, unfortunately, the house is such a good spot to hang your wasp nest. Yeah,
kind of like bees. You can't really control where they go. No. So if you do get them, you have to call.
Although they do like to use the bug hotels. So if you could put your bug hotel down the end of your garden and you'll get at least a few of them heading that way. But sadly, they'll probably still want to come and hang out with you. My uncle has his own trapdoor spider variation named after him by... he's got a trapdoor spider named after him. Oh, that's cool. That's right. Do you know, we have hardly found any of our bugs. In fact, I think they kind of estimate that around a third of our bugs have been found. Yeah. So you can literally go in your back garden still and discover brand new species of bug. And if you do like that, you get to name it after yourself.
Yeah, some bugs only come out every couple of years, like cicadas, they'd be hard to find.
Yeah.
And because some bugs change in their lifestyle, their size and shape, metamorphosis, it's hard to keep track of.
Cicadas are interesting because kids named all the cicadas. And that's why they've got cool names like the greengrocer and, you know, red eye and stuff like that. And so the scientists didn't get to name them. The kids did. So,
bit of fun.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of adorable jumping spiders in my area?
There are.
So it depends where
jumping
you
spiders. Oh, there's jumping spiders everywhere. They are absolutely everywhere. Okay. Antlion. Oh, yeah. So antlions, they make a, yeah, so you're talking about, okay, going back to this crater in the garden. So if it's sandy, like a sandy crater, yeah, you're right, it might be an antlion. An antlion is the larvae of the lace wings.
Yeah.
So it's a little bug with beautiful, beautiful, delicate wings. But the baby looks like a monster. God, it's got this giant mouth. And the poor ant falls down into the pit and then gets eaten by this monster of an antlion. And then they just turn into something so pretty. It's incredible.
It's a lace wing, wasn't it?
Yep, lace wing. We'll bring up a picture so that you guys can see what it looks like. A really delicate adult from such a brutish type of baby. Okay, my kids play with stink bugs. Oh, so they got the orange.
That is what an adult looks like.
Okay, oh, so there's a lace wing.
And I'll get a baby.
Yeah, don't let your kids play with. Oh dear. Okay. Here's the ant lion before we.
So it's a very demonish.
See those? Yeah, see the jaws on it? Oh my goodness.
Oh, here's a bit of one with the jaws.
Do I need to get rid of this picture?
No, it's okay. They can see.
Yeah, that. Okay. Cool. Yeah, no, their ant lions have ferocious jaws. I would not let kids play with stink bugs because they really can squirt out the chemical quite far. The citric acid, and if it gets in your eyes, it literally, it can even blind.
They smell very nice.
Yeah.
My kids in my school always playing with them and just reek the rest of the day.
Okay, once I had a huntsman crawling all over me, how big can they get?
The size of your
hands. Yes.
But they're the social huntsmen that get that big.
Ah. Oh.
They're generally smaller in the body, sort of have a pinkish colour.
Really long legs.
And really long legs. That's mainly their size, their long legs.
Yeah, and the social huntsman is a really common one around Sydney. And it lives with lots of other huntsman spiders. So most spiders just want to live by themselves. But the social huntsman, they found one colony that had 300 of them living together.
So if you find a couple of pinkish huntsmans in your house, you've got a family living somewhere.
Okay.
That always scares people.
Yeah, that's what we think, Abby. So antlions, they do those funny little, it's almost cone-like in your garden, but it'll be really sandy. What's that?
Can we end this meeting?
Yes. Yes, we can. Where's that?
If you want to leave.
Oh, you can leave at any time. Yeah. Oh, goodness. We're just trying to answer a few questions. Yeah, yep. Okay. Oh, that's Caitlin and Ari. Yep, go out, enjoy the day, Caitlin and Ari. What attracts stink bugs to your garden? Well, they're attracted just to the plants. So they're drinking the sap of plants.
There are loads of lychee. You get trapped to certain plants and all that. And, yeah. Depends what you've got in your garden and where you're located.
Yeah, that's it. Someone's got stink bugs on the lychee tree. Oh, didn't even know you could. Where are you located? I don't know.
I don't think it
happened. Can you throw lychees in the city? If you can, I am in. Love lychees. Abby, tell me if I can grow lychees in Sydney, because I am definitely in. I didn't realise stink bugs went on the lychee, but same things, being there quick.
They're just a scrubbable tree, I think.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Oh, you can good bananas, so why not?
It's got to keep them watered.
There are lots of, not all of them are stink bugs as such, but
So this is the abbey. I've seen orange and black and green and red ones. There's lots of different types of bugs that will drink sap. And some of them even drink blood out of animals, assassin bugs.
Yeah,
they'll drink, you know, blood and guts out of animals.
Stink bugs is just that one type of bug that you find around here, but there'll be lots of bugs with stink bugs on a tree.
Mm. Yeah, but on your citrus, the bronze orange stink bug, that's the one that everyone gets. Doesn't matter. You see what would matter? Because I got your lemon tree. At least I have one lemon tree that's
my free. My grandmother's lemon tree. I think I had the aphids once or twice and that's it.
Yeah, right.
It's a really good one.
There you go. I think that was the end of our question time.
Yeah.
Excellent. Oh, that was fun. Our questions. Species. Oh, thank you very much.
I know, you're saying large stink bugs are species.
That's great.
I know. I thought that, oh, right, sorry. I thought they were on a lychee tree. I was excited. I thought, can I grow lychees?
All right. Well, thank you very much for a fun show. I loved all the videos of the dancing bugs.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Oh, they are, aren't they?
Yeah. Okay. So if you want to catch up with Vanessa and Sean, you've got a website, haven't you, Vanessa, as well?
So rangersontherun.com.au.
Fantastic. All right. Okay. Thanks, everybody. And we'll see you next time. Actually, yeah. See you next time. Bye.
Yes.